Yeah, I'm going to leave you my baby, right? So then you give me the 100 grand and then you know that I'm going to come back. And I said, so what if you don't come back with my 100 grand? I said, I'm left with your baby. I said, and that ain't worth 100 grand to me. I said, and do you know what I'm going to do with it? I said, I'm going to rick its neck and I'm going to sling it in a skip. I said, and I don't really want to kill your baby, but if you don't come back with my gear, with the gear that you say you will, that is what's going to happen. And I don't want to wring the neck of your baby. So just go away. This trade isn't happening. Forget about it. Right? Anyway, he was a bit shocked. Hello, my name's Peter Bleksley. I'm 62, which is why I whisper that. I'm now an author and a broadcaster. But prior to that, a long time ago, I was a detective in the Metropolitan Police.
And could you give us a brief description of your history as a detective?
Yeah, so I joined the cops as a raw 17-year-old cadet. Spent 18 months getting physically fit and learning to do what I was told, which I hadn't done prior to that, I've got to be honest. Discipline, haircut, shiny boots, all that sort of stuff. And then at the age of 18 and a half, I became a PC, did my basic training, which was 16 weeks in those days, and then got posted to Peckham as a uniform PC in 1978. Peckham's in South East London, and it was, and to a certain extent remains, one of the bad lands of South East London, although it's got an awful lot going for it.
Okay, cool. So what is the most dangerous place you've been, or the most dangerous situation you feel like you've been put in as a detective?
Policing is a risky job. There's always a fear of violence, and I've been in many scrapes, particularly during the 10 years or more when I worked undercover. So I pretended to be a gangster and spent a lot of time in the company of criminals, convincing them that I was one of theirs. I've stared down the barrel of a sawn-off shotgun from about that far away when I found a murderer who'd escaped from prison. I found him in the back of a van one morning, and I was a bit surprised to find him in the back of that van. He popped up from underneath a blanket and put the double-barreled sawn off under my nose. I ran very, very quickly, shouting and swearing at my mates that he's got an effing gun. Fortunately, he stayed in the van because I drew my gun once I dived down in front of a car and told him that he was surrounded by armed police. He wasn't. It was only me with a gun at that point. But fortunately, he believed me. I was that convincing. And 36 hours later, after a siege and major parts of London had been sealed off and all of that, he put the sawn-off shotgun in his mouth and blew his brains out. So I came very, very close that day to potentially losing my life. And there were other occasions when I faced firearms and got stabbed. I got stabbed in the neck once, and I've still got the scar there. Unfortunately, I faced a fair bit of violence when I was in the cops.
What was your upbringing like? Do you feel that your upbringing had an impact on your career choices?
I was raised by my mum, by and large, because my alcoholic dad was very rarely there. And when he was, it was misery. When he left, when I was about 10 or 11, it was kind of good riddance to bad rubbish, really. We had to sell the house. Obviously, my mum couldn't afford it on her own. Moved into a flat with my mum. My sister went off to nursing, my older sister. And I was a bit of a fool, really, because I didn't have any male role models in my life. My granddad died when I was 12, and I deeply loved him. But there wasn't any men that I could look up to and think, oh, I'd like to be like him, or I like the way that he conducts himself, or I like the way that he works hard for a living, or the way that he looks after his family and his wife and those kind of things. There wasn't any of that. So I just went off the rails, bunked off school a lot of time, got involved in some petty crime, shoplifting, criminal damage, all that kind of nonsense, and was fortunate not to get arrested for it. And it was only really when I joined the police cadets that I have to thank my mum for that, because I got home from work one day and there was this enormous copper sitting in the lounge of our flat. And my mum had arranged for him to come round. And he sat down with me. My mum knew that things weren't going great. And he just sold the idea to me of joining the police cadets and then becoming a constable and all the other options that were open then. And there's even more options and variety and different types of roles you can do within the police these days. He did a great job, pulled out the application form, and before he'd left, I'd filled it in. And a few short weeks later, I was in.
That's crazy. What is the craziest thing you have encountered as a police detective then?
I think the case that really kind of changed my life forever, caused me a lot of grief and aggravation, was when I was undercover, asked to go on a case, working undercover with a guy from what was then called Her Majesty's Customs and Excise, the Customs for short. And we together posed as people who wanted to buy huge quantities of heroin. It ended up with 15 kilos of heroin being delivered to me in a hotel at Gatwick Airport, which at the time, we're talking about the early 90s now, was the largest seizure, land-side seizure. So not at a port or an airport, but like within the mainland. At the time, that was the largest seizure ever of heroin in the UK. That job kind of went okay from my perspective and the perspective of the other undercover cop, in so much as that the bad guys were arrested, the drugs were seized, and nobody came to any harm, albeit there had been a big suggestion that they would turn up with firearms and all of that. And then a few months later, I got a phone call from one of the bosses at Scotland Yard saying, "Don't go home." And I was like, "Why not?" And they said, "Well, we're not going to talk about it on the phone. Just get into Scotland Yard 9 o'clock tomorrow morning and we'll tell you what it's all about. Meanwhile, book into a hotel using one of your false identities," because I had false credit cards, passports and all that for my undercover work. "Get your girlfriend to go and pack an overnight bag at your flat, but you're not to go there. And we'll tell you what it's about in the morning." So I didn't get to the yard at 9 o'clock because I'm a detective. I got there at 8 o'clock. And a mate of mine said, "Have you seen this?" And he pulled out a report. It was a briefing note on the operation, which was called Operation Zulu Cricket. He locked me in a side room. He said, "Well, there's a copy for you to keep, because you might well need it, and you need to read this." Well, it was astonishing. And it revealed how the people that we'd arrested and their contacts were going to terminate me, to use their terminology. They discovered that I was an undercover cop, but they worked it out. And they weren't going to let it rest, which was another quote. And so they were actively planning to get an assassin to come to the UK and kill me. The threat, okay, that was a bit unsettling, but being threatened was kind of par for the course. But what had happened was that report I was reading had been stolen out of an unmarked police car. I mean, first of all, my real name should not have been in that report. My undercover number should have been in there. That report should never have been printed out and taken away from police premises. It most certainly should not have gone in the back of an unmarked police car, which was then left unattended so the report could be nicked. I mean, conspiracy after conspiracy after conspiracy. By the end of that working day, when I was at the yard, it was decided that I had to abandon my identity, my life, my home, and I was parachuted into the Witness Protection Programme, where I lived for the next 2 years. Not only did I live in witness protection, but I still had to work. So I was working undercover as well, as well as dreading walking out of the front door of my home. Well, it wasn't a home, it was a hideout, because I didn't want the neighbours saying, "Oh, and what do you do? And where do you come from? And, you know, where did you live previously?" Because I'd have just had to keep putting lie upon lie upon lie. 2 years of that, living, working, breathing undercover, worrying about the constant threat of the assassin's bullet in the back of my head, conspiracy theorising as to how this situation had ever got to this, and I drank too much, and I smoked too much. So I did pay a part in my own downfall. After 2 years of that, I had a catastrophic mental health breakdown, and I ended up being admitted to a lock-in psychiatric ward.
That's mad. What stories stand out from your time spent in witness protection?
Just the miserable time that it was, really. I just tried to self-medicate you know, through drinking and blurring it all out and waking up in the morning and hoping that things were different. But of course they wouldn't be, because I'd come downstairs in the morning, go to my doormat, and there is my post in the name of the undercover name that I'm living in. So there's that constant reminder. You know, I've always been a neighbourly bloke. I like to talk to my neighbours and have a chit-chat, just passing the time of day and looking out for one another. I love all of that, always have done. But now that was all taken away from me. I would come out and basically kind of keep my head down. And of course, what was the only shop I used to go to? The off licence, to get more booze, to come back and have another drink and blot it all out again. So it was a really sort of miserable period, as well as when I got up in the morning, went out to the car or van or whatever vehicle I was driving. And of course, I'd check underneath it to make sure no bastard had put a bomb there, because it was a very real threat. The people that wanted to kill me had terrorism links and they had capabilities. So it was just miserable, thoroughly miserable. You know, I had a son at the time out of a relationship that wasn't marriage, but he and I have always been very close and still are all these years later. And, you know, going to meet him with a covert surveillance team at either end of the street, you know, which his mother never knew about. And, oh, it was just ghastly, a ghastly, ghastly time. It wasn't very well thought out. It was utterly unmanageable. There was no long-term planning behind it. And to be perfectly honest with you, it's no surprise that it ended catastrophically like it did. But I'm still here. You know, the wonderful people at the NHS that helped me get better. I kind of owe my lives to them. And albeit it signalled the end of my police career and it was a long, difficult kind of exit from the cops. But when that came about, I've always said since then the most important thing is my mental health, because if I don't look after my mental health, nothing else really counts. So I still take a small maintenance dose of medication. I've had counselling over the years whenever I felt I've needed it. I talk willingly and openly, not only here on camera, but to those that I trust, my mates, my wife, because talking is important. So if you're having mental health issues, please get the help you need, please talk. And if the meds are right, and invariably they are, please take them. And there's no shame in it, by the way. No shame at all.
Is there an instance where you got injured during a case?
Yeah, so stabbed in the neck. That was when I wasn't in an undercover role, but I'd gone out to help on an undercover operation because the new detective inspector in charge of the case, what was new to that kind of work. So the undercover cops, they'd done their job very well. The drugs had been seized. The people had been arrested in the car park. That was all hunky-dory. But surveillance had seen the bad guys going to and from a particular address, a flat up the back of some metal stairs and the back of some shops. So I got hold of the detective inspector and I said, we've got to go through that door now, because of course that's where the drugs had come from. So the bad guy that was left in the flat was expecting a big bag of money to be coming his way very soon. And when it didn't, of course he's going to be getting twitchy and nervous and anxious. So I was saying to this new detective inspector, we've got to go through that door now. Anyway, he dillied and he dallied, and I kept saying, we've got to go. Anyway, we didn't until about 20 minutes later. And I kind of knew that it probably wasn't going to be a great scene that we would find behind that door. Anyway, I'm checking the door to make sure that we can get in it, because there's nothing more embarrassing than kicking a front door and breaking your foot and not being able to get in. You know, you've got to do your work. Check the hinges, check which side the hinges are on. Check which side the locks are on. Check if there's any give in any particular top or bottom of the door. Where's going to be the best place to attack it, take it off its hinges and get in quickly and as safely as we can. Anyway, I'm doing all of that and I'm confronted, of course, as the door flies open by a very, very irate man who's got a knife in his hand. And I kind of blurt out that I'm a cop, but it all gets lost in the blur. And he goes, bang. And fortunately, you know, at the time I was young and fit and fearless and I could see the hand coming towards me. He still got me, but I kind of, as I tried to turn, made it a bit more of a perhaps a glancing blow than a, you know, directly in sort of blow that it could have been. So I've got him and I've managed to keep hold of him and I've got his wrists. I've got him over some railings. And of course, in one hand, he's still holding the knife, which is covered in blood. And I realise that that's my blood. And that ain't a great feeling, you know. I'm thinking, well, how badly injured am I? Fortunately, colleagues came up the stairs pretty swiftly afterwards. They grabbed hold of him. Somebody wrapped a scarf around my neck because I was losing quite a bit of blood. They took me down the back of the stairs, sat me on the ground, and we waited for the ambulance. I didn't want to breathe in too deeply because what I didn't want to do was inhale my own blood, bearing in mind I still didn't know how badly I'd been injured. So the ambulance came. Paramedics left the scarf in situ. You know, put further bandaging on and all that sort of stuff. Blue lighted me to the hospital. Straight into A&E, crash into A&E. Straight up to a doctor who was a very tall lady. One of those lovely kind of no-nonsense sort of people that I really like. Takes off the bandaging, removes the scarf, takes one look at it and she goes, flesh wound, few stitches, you'll be fine. And I was like, thank you so much, doctor. Thank you. And in her very matter-of-fact way, she just wiped away the blood, got the needle, got the thread, stitched me up, and that was it. I was out of hospital about an hour later.
Are there many, like, detective clubs or secret societies that you think would be interesting to sort of know? And what do you think about them, if there are any?
When I was a young cop and a young detective, a lot of police officers were Freemasons. Now, I don't think police officers should be able to join Freemasonry. Freemasonry calls itself not a secret society, but a society with secrets. Either way, I think it's bollocks. And I would never want to join it. And I don't think that police officers should join it. I don't think police officers should be allowed to join a society with secrets. They should be open, transparent, honest, and upstanding members of society. I'm not saying that Freemasons aren't, but I know back in my day, there was a lot of favours done and a lot of promotions and all that kind of stuff, purely and simply because people were Freemasons. I saw some Freemasons promoted when really they shouldn't have been police cadets, let alone chief inspectors and the like. So it had a really odious, pervasive, corrupt influence on the police back in the day. And I still don't think, I'm repeating myself, I know, I still don't think police officers should be Freemasons. There is an organisation called the Metropolitan Police Ex-Detectives Association, of which I was a member for a few years, but I got booted out last year. And I got booted out because they said that I brought the association into disrepute. Do you know what I did? I told the truth. I went in the media because it was the anniversary of Brixton. It was 40 years since the Brixton riots. And I told the truth on TV, in the papers, on the radio about how certain cops I'd worked with were racist, vile, brutal thugs. Our young black men were beaten up and fitted up. I told the truth. And a lot of white, old, retired, truth-denying police officers went frigging ballistic. So what? Did I give a shit? No, of course I didn't. But the the chair of the Metropolitan Police Ex-Detectives Association rang me up and said, Peter, you've brought the association into disrepute, so we are kicking you out. And I said, before you go, can I just clarify one thing here? I've brought your association into disrepute because I told the truth. Silence at the other end. Yeah, well, if telling the truth is disreputable to that association, I want nothing to do with it and I'm glad to be out of it.
That ties quite nicely into my next question, which is, have you ever witnessed police corruption firsthand?
One of the most astonishing stories of police corruption was when I was a Scotland Yard detective. I was working undercover. I had quite a reputation as being a decent operator. and a young detective who was fairly new on a squad gave me a ring, and his voice was breaking. He was clearly in a bad way. And he said, Blex, we've got to meet. We've got to have a meet. And I could tell, you know, this was serious. So I said, okay, I'll get away from work whenever I can. We arranged to have a meet. And I met up with this young detective who just had, like, worry written all over his face. He said, Blex, he said, now, he said, my team have gone out and done a search of premises of someone's house or garage. I don't know what, I can't remember what the premises were. We've done a search, drug dealers, and we found £200,000 and we've nicked it. So on our team, I'm talking about his team, on his team, I think there was 14 people or maybe 17. But anyway, they had what they called the inner sanctum. So 10 of them were corrupt, but they operated as a team within a team. So the other four or the other seven were kind of like straight runners, as they thought it. So they wouldn't tell them, or they wouldn't be a party to any of the corrupt things that the other 10 were getting up to. So he said, we've nicked 200 grand and we've all had 20 grand each, right? Tax-free, you know what I mean? You don't declare it. So he said, but he said, one of the blokes on the inner sanctum, so one of the 10, is going out with one of the officers on the team who's not in the inner sanctum, right? And he has divvied up his 20 grand and he's given her 10. So of course, when the other 9 corrupt cops found out about it, they were like, what on earth have you done? You've given a straight runner 10 grand who we can't trust. Just because you're going out with her doesn't mean to say we can trust her. And they were all terrified because they thought that she would then go off to the complaints department, grass them all up, and they'd all be looking at significant jail terms. It gets better or worse, should I say. He said, so the 9 have decided that they're going to kill her, right? A fellow detective. They're going to kill her so that she cannot be a threat, so that she cannot go to the authorities, the complaints department, and so that they cannot be captured for their corrupt activities and all sent to prison. So he said, now, I know I've done wrong. I know that taking that 20 grand is wrong. He said, but killing one of our own, he said, that's just like a different level, he said. And I just don't know what to do. He said, what would you do, Blex? So we had a chat. And I said, well, leave it with me. Now, I didn't have first-hand evidence. I did ask him if he was going to throw himself on his sword and go to the authorities and say he was sorry, take his prison sentence and all that kind of stuff. But I don't think that was ever going to happen. I certainly, and I'll take all the criticism that anybody wants to throw at me, I wasn't going to go and grass them up. But what I didn't want to happen was this officer to be murdered. You know, I really, really did not want that to happen. So let's just say I went off and I had a meeting. That officer did not get murdered. And what did happen at some later stage, for entirely unconnected crimes, some of those officers were arrested and convicted for entirely unconnected crimes. And the officer didn't get murdered. Not a perfect world, not a perfect solution. I don't come out of it covered in glory, I get that. But that's how it was.
Is there a standout story that you've never told that you'll be able to share with us today?
Well, you know, in 20 years of being rent-a-gob on the TV and radio and writing books and, you know, all of that, I've pretty much told most of the stories. There's one that I haven't told very much, I should say. And I kind of find it mildly amusing. When I was at the peak of my powers as an undercover cop, a lot of people thought they wanted to have a go at working undercover. And the kind of a good way to get into the undercover work and, you know, get your name known and all that sort of stuff would be a job with me, do a job with me, because I did have a higher profile. You know, if it sounds like I'm boasting, then forgive me, but, you know, we're talking about from the mid-'80s to the mid-'90s. I was incredibly proficient at working undercover. You know, I bought millions upon millions of pounds worth of drugs. I knew my way around gear like you wouldn't believe, no matter what it was. I could talk the talk, I could walk the walk. I was very convincing. I bought guns, millions of dollars of counterfeit currency, stolen goods, high value goods, lorry loads of trainers, you know, all that kind of stuff. And so people would want to go out on a job with me. They'd want to be my driver or my minder as a way of getting their, you know, getting a bit of a reputation working undercover and thereby getting more work. So one bloke pestered me incessantly. Blex, can I do a job with you? Blex, please, 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 please let me do a job with you. Please let me do a job with you. This went on for goodness knows how long. And in the end, I mean, I quite liked the bloke. You know, he was a likeable sort of fella. And I said, yeah, all right, because a particular job came up and it was North London. And I said, yeah, come on, come and be my driver on this job. So we've got a big old motor, big old high-powered sort of, I don't know, Ford Sierra or something like that. You know, not a policey one, you know, but a proper big old police car or a BMW or a Merc or whatever it was. You know, I'm not a petrolhead. It was just a big, powerful lump of a motor. But he seemed like a reasonable driver and all that, and he knew when to talk and, more importantly, when to keep his trap shut. And it kind of went okay. And we got to the day of the trade, and, of course, that is always the time when tension is at its highest, because I've got to do three things. Number one, I've got to make sure the gear comes onto the plot. Number two, I've got to make sure the situation is such that the bad guys can be arrested. And number three, probably, I've got to be able to escape. So I've got this brand new driver with me. Anyway, negotiating a pub, and we're on it for a few hours and this, that and the other. Then we're in a big pub car park outside the front of a pub, embedded in a sort of deepest, darkest North London. And a gear arrives. And the bad guys are really, really twitchy. They really, really want the money really, really quickly. And I've got the money in a bag in the boot of this big old lump of a car that my inexperienced undercover driver is at the steering wheel of. So anyway, I go to one car, see the parcel, check the parcel, pull it out, kind of see that there's, I don't know, it was pills. It was a pills job. So I think I was buying 20,000-30,000 pills or something. And then the guy comes with me and I'm going to show him the money. We're going to arrange to, you know, do the exchange. Anyway, so I would invariably give a signal to the surveillance cops, the brilliant men and women who you just wouldn't notice even if you were looking for them. Surveillance is a really great art. And I did it a lot in the cops. I've done it in the private sector as well. I still love doing surveillance. It's a real, real skill, and it can be a very incredibly satisfying job to do. So the wonderful surveillance people are doing their thing, not being seen by the bad guys, but they've got eyes on me. And they're looking out for me to give a particular signal. I'm not going to give away the signal now, just in case undercover cops are still using them. And when I give my signal, that basically says, yeah, the gear's here, nick the bad guys. Anyway, I give the signal and nothing happens. So now I've got the bad guy near me and I'm showing him the money in the boot. And I'm thinking, come on, I gave the signal minutes ago and nothing's happening, nothing's happening, nothing's happening. And now, of course, he's getting really twitchy and he actually wants to take the money with him, which is not unreasonable, bearing in mind that I've seen the pills and I'm about to make them mine. Anyway, not long after, all hell breaks loose as cops from the arrest team start leaping out of everywhere. There's chaos, there's cars driving, this, that and the other. And it's at that time, if you're undercover, you've got to keep a cool head. It really does help. Anyway, so I'm in the boot of this great lump of a car, wrestling with this bad guy who wants to take the money. And I'm not letting him take the money at the moment. There's all merry hell breaking loose with cars pulling in, people jumping out, people getting arrested and all of that. And my novice undercover driver suddenly decides that he's going to hit the accelerator, right? So he hits the accelerator, travels about a yard before he slams the brake on, and I'm deep in the boot. And what happens? The boot comes down, bang, right on my head, right? Thank you very much. What happens? My head splits open, right? I'm still wrestling with this guy with the money. I managed to get the bag off him. I'm really irritated now because this big, heavy lump of a boot has smacked me, bang, right on my swede. So I've thrown the money in, and at that point, it's all chaos, and I think I better leg it, right? So I leg it out this pub car park, you know, over cars and fences and all that sort of stuff, and I'm legging it up the road. And, of course, head injuries bleed a lot. You know, they often look a lot worse than what they are. And, of course, I'm running, so my heart's pumping. I'm running up the street and blood is pumping out my head. Some of the surveillance team are going, like they're getting on the radio, going, Blex has got blood pumping out of his head, or whatever code name they'll be calling me then. So there's not only all the pandemonium in the pub car park of tablets and money and bad guys getting nicked and cars and all of that. There's me going like a long dog up the road. Yeah, I know it was a long time ago, right? It was a bit thinner, a bit quicker. I get it, right? And blood pumping out of me. Anyway, eventually, one of the team kind of like scoops me up and I, you know, put something to stop the bleeding. And yet again, I find myself on the way to hospital. Anyway, again, it was a clean up and just a few stitches and that was all fine. But it was, they panicked because they really didn't know what had happened to me. Just somebody just piped up on the radio. He's running up the road with blood pumping out of his head. But anyway, all's well that ends well.
What's the craziest thing they had you watching over whilst obviously being on surveillance? Because you mentioned briefly you did that for the private sector as well, didn't you?
Yeah, yeah, and surveillance is great. It's really good, you know, particularly when you've got criminals that think they're surveillance aware. So they think they can spot you. So they go three times round a roundabout and they jump red traffic lights and all that kind of stuff. And they're always looking in the rearview mirror, you know, to see. It's incredibly satisfying when you do that and you are able to anticipate and combat all their anti-surveillance skills. And now, of course, technology plays another huge part in the great skill of surveillance. We had many, many a memorable time. Particularly, we did a surveillance job, and we were trying to pinpoint the offices where we knew this team of villains worked. And it was where we felt they did their business. And eventually, one day, we see them driving up this pathway between two houses. Just a driveway between two houses. So we couldn't follow them up there, obviously, because we'd have been easily spotted. And there was a quarry on the other side. We're looking at map books, obviously. We always had map books in the car back in the day. And we can see there's a quarry. To cut a long story short, we waited till they came out of there. We'd already identified where they lived. And then that night, we clambered into the quarry, through it, down one side, across the bottom of it, up the other side, up to a fence, did a recce of this porter cabin type office. And then a couple of nights, we went back with the technical guys. So these are the people that can covertly get into premises without leaving a trace, and they can install the audio and video monitoring equipment, again, without leaving a trace. Independently power sourced, so even if they turned all their power off and looked at the electricity meter and it was still going round, then of course they can tell that there's something in there that shouldn't be. So, you know, counted all of that. And then we set up a listening post, not very far away from there. Again, very covert. And for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks, we listened to all their criminal plotting and planning. And bit by bit, arrest by arrest, seizure by seizure, we took down their criminal organisation, because these guys didn't ever get their hands dirty. They were just the kingpins. And of course, because we took everybody out, in the end, they had no choice but to get their hands dirty. And it was at that point that they got arrested as well. And that organisation was dismantled.
So what sort of training do you have to go through to become an undercover detective?
Back in my day, there was no training. There was no recruitment. There was no selection process. But because we were so successful in the mid-80s, we ended up setting up a Scotland Yard squad called SO10. And after that, we formalised the recruitment and the training and the vetting. And that, of course, has been taken on to completely different levels now, all these decades later. So it's very, very different. A word of warning for anybody who's thinking about going into undercover policing, the casualty rate is high. I'm not the only undercover cop who's had mental health issues. I know a considerable number of others who have. Physical danger, of course, always there. Sadly, some undercover cops have been badly hurt over the years. So please think very, very carefully about doing it. But if you think you could be a professional liar, and remember that the best lies to tell are the ones that are closest to the truth, because they're easiest to remember. For example, I could never have professed to have been privately educated and be an expert in fine art, right? I couldn't have carried that off for a minute. But what I could pretend to be was a South East London oik who knew his way round a parcel of gear, you know, ran a few dodgy businesses perhaps, which is why I always had lots of money. And I always used to talk about the three Fs when I was undercover. Stick to what you know. And I would talk about the three Fs. And in fact, the three Fs are still incorporated, I know, into current undercover police training. Not as something you have to do, but as something that shows that I spoke about what I knew, what I could talk about. And they are, pardon the language, fighting, fucking and football. Right? They were the three things that I knew a bit about and that I could talk about. And that's why I stuck to those kind of subjects.
Could you tell us about your first experience with a firearm?
Well, in sort of around about the early 80s to the mid 80s, when I became a detective in 1982, and there was a lot of armed crime going on, a lot of gun crime. Quite a few armed robberies, albeit that was tailing off, but a lot of drug dealers were arming themselves. And I thought, if they're going to have guns, I might as well have a gun. So I applied to become a firearms officer. I got through that selection process, did the training, passed that. I didn't carry a gun every day, but whenever we felt we might need one, obviously I had what we call our pink ticket, and I'd go and book one out. It saved my life when I found that murderer in the van, definitely, because having a gun on me that day enabled me to shout as convincingly as I could that he was surrounded by armed police. And if he had come out of that van, all guns blazing, then I think I had a pretty good opportunity to have shot him. Again, the training now has moved on, is much more rigorous, and you can't be a detective in a CID office and just walk down to the station sergeant and say, there's my pink ticket, I want a gun, please, Sarge. It's moved on a lot from those days. But I did think long and hard before I became a firearms officer, because I thought, I didn't really join the police to kill people, I joined the police to sort of save people and catch murderers. So I did spend a long time thinking about whether I actually could point that gun, pull the trigger and take somebody's life. And I decided that I could, if need be. I'm very glad that I didn't. Carrying a gun was often very important for me.
Whilst undercover, what stories do you have from posing as a criminal?
Well, there's many of them, you know, not only about getting my head split open and having to live in witness protection and all of that. Unfortunately, in the illegal drugs industry, people often big themselves up. So they say they're capable of dealing a lot more drugs than they actually can. And on one such occasion, there was a fairly young fella. He was desperate to do a trade with me. And he was convinced that he could bring me 5 kilos of heroin. Not heroin. 4 or 5 kilos of cocaine. And I think the trade was set for about 100,000 pounds. But it became obvious to me that he didn't really have the authority within that criminal organisation to be released that bigger quantity of drugs. You know, it still remains a sizable parcel, 4 or 5 kilos of Charlie, you know. It's worth a lot of money. It's a big parcel. And those who control it don't want to lose it. Anyway, this young fella kept on and on and on at me. Please, Peter. But he kept insisting that I gave him my 100 grand and he'd come back with the drugs. Yeah, right. Like that is ever going to happen, right? It simply isn't. Could you imagine? I give £100,000 of the Commissioner of the Metropolitan Police's money to some bloke who then disappears off with it. And I'm left sitting there looking like a fool. And I have to explain to everybody why I've just lost 100 grand, right? That ain't ever going to happen. But this young man was insisting upon it. Anyway, he knew it wasn't going to happen. And at the end of the day, I just wanted to walk away because I didn't want to force him into doing a deal that was bigger than his position within the criminal organisation. You know, I wasn't that desperate to find drug dealers, you know what I mean? That's not my role, to almost be like an agent provocateur and force somebody into doing something that they wouldn't normally do. That's not how it goes, certainly not in my book. So we have this last sort of meeting, and I'm basically going to tell him, you know, all right, off you go, mate, never mind. So he turns up at this meeting, right, and sitting at the other end of the pub is his girlfriend and their young baby. And he then said to me, Peter, he said, look, if you give me the 100 grand, I will leave my baby with you, right, as collateral, to guarantee that I will then come back with the drugs. Right? His baby. He's willing to give me his baby so that this drug deal can be done, right? Well, of course, that's the end of it. Now, please just remember that what I'm going to say next is me in an undercover role. It is not actually me, because I'm a father of 3 boys, you know what I mean? And I love them all. And I'm a complete sucker for a baby. If I see a baby, you know, being pushed down the road in a buggy, I get all broody and wish I could rewind a clock, you know? I'm a marshmallow at heart. Anyway, so he says, yeah, I'm going to leave you my baby, right? So then you give me the 100 grand and then you know that I'm going to come back. And I said, so what if you don't come back with my 100 grand? I said, I'm left with your baby. I said, and that ain't worth 100 grand to me. I said, and do you know what I'm going to do with it? I said, I'm going to rick its neck and I'm going to sling it in a skip. I said, and I don't really want to kill your baby, but if you don't come back with my gear, with the gear that you say you will, that is what's going to happen. And I don't want to wring the neck of your baby. So just go away. This trade isn't happening. Forget about it. Right? Anyway, he was a bit shocked at the prospect of me wringing his kid's neck and slinging it in a skip. Of course, I would never have done that, all right? Please. Anyway, so he toddled off with his tail between his legs. That trade never happened. Some of the bosses back at the yard really had the hump with me because I deliberately, you know, cancelled the deal. But I said, again, I'm not doing that. I'm not forcing a bloke into committing a crime that he's not really capable of doing. That's just not on. But yeah, and there's more. And if you want to hear more stories of me working undercover, you can always buy my autobiography, Gangbuster. But there you go. Forgive the plug.
How have you been treated by fellow detectives since leaving?
Well, when I left the cops, so I got medically retired. I was about 40 years of age. Flunked my education, of course, foolishly. So I've got next to no qualifications. No trade. You know, I'm not a chippy or a spark or a plumber or anything like that. I found myself on the scrap heap of life and I really didn't know what I was going to do. After giving it some thought, I decided that I'd try and get a publishing deal for my autobiography. And when I made that known, One of my former colleagues took me to a pub, and I thought we were just going for a, you know, a bit of a chat or a social, with a couple of former colleagues of his with him. And he said, so you're going to write a book? I said, yeah, that's right. He said, no, you ain't. You will not write this book. And I went, do you know what? You're not my sergeant anymore. You have no control over me anymore. And I am going to write this book. I was then a little bit impolite towards him, at which point I got up, finished my drink and walked out of the pub. So, yeah, I was very unpopular when Gangbuster came out. I had threatening phone calls, anonymous, of course, you know. They never got the balls to come and knock on your door and do it. But I found out who my real friends are. See? And people that I thought were my friends simply and happily disappeared out my life. And they've never come back. And I won't let them back in. So it was good. You find out, you know, it's when you have the bad times, the tough times, that you really find out who's important to you in your life, who your proper mates are. And I've got enough proper mates. I haven't got thousands. I haven't got hundreds. But I've just got enough. Just enough proper, proper mates. So, yeah, been unpopular. Then that recent story getting kicked out of the Ex-Detectives Association. You know, I'm a bit unconventional. I don't kind of toe the line necessarily. I don't break the law, you know, but I'm not afraid to challenge the establishment through my writing, through my broadcasting, through my research, through my investigations. I'll always hold the establishment to account. I think that's my job as a writer. So... I think I have one friend that's an ex-cop. Yeah, just the one. And he's the greatest mate on earth. And he's the only mate from the cops I need.
Amazing, mate. Do you want to tell us about your hunt for Kevin Parle?
My life is dominated and has been for the last 33 months by my hunt for Mr. Kevin Parle, 6'6" Liverpudlian, born and raised in the south side of Liverpool, speaks with a soft sort of Liverpool accent, not a very broad Scouser. And he is wanted, he's on the National Crime Agency's most wanted list for two separate murders. The first one in 2004 is the shooting dead of a 16-year-old boy, yes, a child. And the second murder that he's wanted for is the shooting dead in August of 2005 of a 22-year-old mother of three young children, Lucy Hargreaves, who has been described to me by anybody that I've met and who knew her as being as beautiful on the inside as she was on the outside. Two dreadful crimes. And after Lucy had been blasted to death with a shotgun, her body and her house was doused in petrol and set alight. The reason I'm hunting Kevin Parle is because in 2019, I left a TV show called Hunted that I'd done six series of, and it was time for me to move on. And because my profile had been raised quite substantially by being prominent in that show, I thought instead of hunting pretend fugitives on the telly for people's entertainment, I'll hunt a real fugitive in the real world for Liam and Lucy, because that's who I'm trying to deliver some form of justice for. Kevin Parle has not been convicted of these crimes, but there is a European arrest warrant out for his arrest. There is a £20,000 reward on offer from Merseyside Police for information leading to his capture. And it's all about Liam and Lucy. It dominates my life, morning, noon and night. But it was my idea, and I'm not looking for a sympathy vote in any way, shape or form. The hunt for Kevin Parle has been the subject of an ongoing BBC podcast called Manhunt, Finding Kevin Parle, which has proved to be very popular, been downloaded over 4 million times and is returning very soon with brand new episodes. Please have a listen. Go back. Listen to the first 12. You'll find out where we were up to just about the start of lockdown. And then please, when the new episodes come out, have a listen to those as well. And you'll see how my investigation is progressing. We won an award. It was the BBC's most popular true crime pod of 2020. And I urge you to listen to it, because I would then like you to spread the word about Kevin Parle. Because every person that hears his name for the first time means that we are just shrinking the world for him, bit by bit, person by person, download by download, shrinking the world. And we're going to squeeze the globe so tightly that at some point his 6'6" ginger nut pops up and law enforcement can slap the handcuffs on. And then he can be put in front of a court of law and he can answer the allegations that are made against him. Because that, I firmly believe, is how the world should revolve. This is about truth over lies. This is about good over evil. And this is about trying to secure some justice for Liam and Lucy, rest their souls. The hunt for Kevin Parle has also been the subject of my latest book, Manhunt. This book is very different from the podcast. The podcast is the story of my investigation, plus more. This is the personal journey that I've been on. These things are not about profit. In the last 33 months, any penny that I have earned out of either of these projects has gone directly back into the hunt for Kevin Parle. Hotels, flights, car hire, petrol, meals on the go, coffee on the go, having these designed and printed. It's about Parle, not profit. I have not put a carrot on my family's dining table. But if you'd like to read that, and or listen to the podcast, because they're both very different vehicles, and please spread the word. I'd be very grateful. If you would like paper, laminated, or electronic versions of the flyer or the poster, they're identical, then please send me a DM on Twitter, message me on Facebook. You're probably way too young to be on Facebook. I'm on Insta, okay, Peter Bleksley on Insta. Please send me a message. Free of charge, I'll put some in the post to you. And if you want the laminated versions that come with pre-drilled holes, I'll even send you some cable ties so you can tie them to a lamppost. I'll do all that, won't cost you a bean. Just drop me a message and I'll happily send them to you. I've been to Spain twice, Glasgow, Manchester, Liverpool many times, Brighton, Bournemouth, Milton Keynes, and many other places, all kind of connected to the hunt for Kevin Parle. And I've got other places to go to as well, which I will be going to soon. Please, come on board, have a listen, have a read. The book's in audiobook as well. And let's put him in front of a court.